Good afternoon. Can everybody hear me? Hi, I am John Hamilton, and I get the honor of emceeing this event today. So we lucked out. It's been raining most of the morning, and the sky has cleared. So woohoo! Just a few housekeeping items. We have food. There are drinks. There are lots of places where you can sign and participate. There are activities for children over here on the picnic tables. And the bathrooms are on the back side of the building right behind you. So that should take care of the housekeeping. I get to take a few minutes now, and I want to introduce somebody who is a pretty important person and a very dear friend. And I get to tell you about my relationship and connection to Mary-Curtis Gramley. So I will tell you this. It was in the late 90s that I first met Mary-Curtis Gramley, and she was tasked with setting up a program called CASA, Court-Appointed Special Advocate. At the time, I worked for the circuit court and was tasked with what was then called the Community Family Court program, and Mary-Curtis got a seat at that table. And what she did was she brought volunteers into the child welfare, child protective system. Now, you can imagine how well that went over with circuit court judges and lawyers and DHS caseworkers and addiction treatment counselors who all thought they were doing a fine job. And then all of a sudden, you have this southern accent sitting at the table saying, we're going to have a volunteer bring a fresh perspective into this. Mary-Curtis was perfect in that role, and in that role, she brought that audacity of questioning the system and how we do things. Proverbs 22:6, Solomon is credited with saying, train up a child in the way they should go, and when they are old, they will not depart from it. That directive, those words of wisdom, I have reflected on as this event has been delayed by COVID several times. The planning for this event has gone on for several years, and COVID has delayed it. But what that delay did was allowed those of us who had an opportunity to speak and learn and talk about Mary-Curtis to truly focus what it is and why it was she had such a profound impact on us and our community. And so Mary-Curtis brought those words and brought that perspective to the table in CASA. From my work at the court, Mary-Curtis said, I need you to go up to Eugene with me, John. And I said, well, I can't. I'm so busy at work. And she says, don't worry. I already talked to the presiding judge, and you have the day off to go with me. And I'm like, wow. This woman's got some nerve. I won't tell you what it was like to drive in that green Volvo with Mary-Curtis. It's the only drive I ever took with her where I'll drive, Mary-Curtis. I got this. But what I will say is from that event and from her perspective, she brought another concept to our community, and that was the Family Nurturing Center, where I spent the better part of 15 years working as a board member and volunteer for that organization. Both CASA and Family Nurturing Center are indispensable parts of the work I do as an attorney in a courtroom for families facing the child welfare system. Those concepts are so integrated in who we are and how we do work now that it's hard to imagine that they didn't exist. And so, my other relationship with Mary-Curtis was as a mentor. I can tell you many, many times as I struggled with a new capacity or a new role in my life where she provided guidance and insight on how to manage those relationships, how to bring about a coalition of folks to accomplish something, and I always could count on her advice. And finally, and probably what makes today and every day since her passing difficult and what's hardest now is I considered her my friend. And so that's the hardest part. That's my perspective. I am one of hundreds of lives and people that she touched and got to be a part of and influence and share and love. And so today, as we celebrate her life, you're going to get an opportunity to to hear from many of those people and from many different perspectives about who Mary-Curtis was, what she meant, what she did. And you're going to hear that from the different voices and different people who she touched. So thank you for joining us today, and thank you for taking this afternoon, which is now absolutely a gorgeous afternoon. And with that said, I'd like to introduce Nadezhda, who will take us to the next part of our celebration today.
Thank you, John, and hello, everyone. My name is Nadezhda. It is truly an honor to have the opportunity to stand here and reflect on our shared love and admiration for Mary-Curtis. As John said, I'm going to echo some themes I heard him say, but it has been kind of, this moment has been long anticipated, and there has been a group of us who have worked together, coming together at different cadences, sometimes weekly, sometimes monthly, really being thoughtful about how best to honor Mary-Curtis. And a lot of the thinking that has gone into this is how best to really capture her legacy and how to focus this experience for all of us here around that. As I've been doing some thinking about what a legacy means in preparation for this moment, I feel that it is so multifaceted, and certainly for Mary-Curtis, I think that is so true. So one aspect of her legacy really is the ways that her dedication and commitment to serving children and families that have needed it the most in this community is reflected in programs and work and a real kind of culture change in terms of how we think about taking care of people. And then there's the legacy that lives on in each of our hearts, and it's such a treat to kind of walk around and talk to people, or even in the past few years in reflecting on her life, and feel the ways that we have so many shared memories, you know, funny things like what it was like to drive a school bus full of toddlers together around West Medford, or just these kind of inexplicable, magical, and sometimes unimaginable shared moments that would happen in just what it took to be a day in the life of the Nurturing Center. It's been such a long time since I was at the Nurturing Center. I first met Mary-Curtis back around the time that John was describing, shortly after the program had just had its first children enrolled. And at that time, the first classroom was in the building that is now kind of, it's behind what is now the Medford Co-op. And there were just two children the first day that I went to go and meet Mary-Curtis. And Mary-Curtis was driving them. She was the bus driver, but the bus was that green Volvo. And she would pick them up and drop them off. And the thing that I remember is that just as soon as I met her, when I went in for my interview or whatever it was I think I fell in love. And I just had this feeling of like I'm forever changed just by having met this person. And for as passionate as I was about children and learning in this space, it was about loving Mary-Curtis kind of right off the bat that had me committed. And when I think over the past now, it's not 20 years, but it's just a little shy of that, I think that there's one thing that has lived on in my heart that is just, there's been lots of change, different jobs, different houses, all different iterations, but there has been kind of an undying commitment for me to continue holding her vision and moving it forward in whatever ways I can. The other part of legacy that I think about is the way that legacy lives on, you know, in each of our unique ways. We all have our Mary-Curtis. There are some people here who I think maybe never even met her, but there's a reason that they're here, a reason that they're touched by her and by the impact. I think we, as a community, got to know her in this very particular chapter. And as my mother has said to me many times, life is long, and there are many chapters. Mary Curtis lived a very full life with many different chapters, and I'm just feeling aware and connected to all of the myriad and countless lives that, in fact, she touched. And then legacy lives on in her husband, Diggs, and their children, Janie and Dale and Walt and Andrew and Joe and their 7 grandchildren. Over the years, I've had opportunity to get to know the family in different ways. Long ago, it was teaching violin to Riley, Owen, and Lucy. All have gone on to do amazing things, and to see the legacy of generations and the spirit that runs through all things, and certainly her heart and passion and dedication and commitment to being a good person in this world lives on strongly. Before I pass this off to Walt, I want to say I had the opportunity to spend a little bit of time with Mary Curtis during the last chapter when she was on hospice. And when I first walked in to their home, where I think all of the children were there, a few impressions I had. She was laying there so radiantly beautiful. All were going about quite diligently gardening, so executing her vision for the flower garden, that if what it seemed like was that there were many different iterations of that. So they would put a flower in, and then, no, maybe that actually wasn't quite the right spot, and the flower would get moved. And to me, it was just such an expression of love and collaboration, and there was quite a bit of humor happening in the room. But the first thing she said when I walked in, and I think it was just she and I in that moment, she looked at me and had that look in her eye and a big smile on her face, but it was just this kind of like, darn it, kind of look. And she goes, I had so much more I wanted to do. And I said, I know, Mary Curtis, you wanted to heal the world. And she said, I really did. And few people really truly woke up every day staring down seemingly insurmountable problems, and as if they were solvable. And I was talking about that with my mom this morning, and she said, yeah, that's how the greats are. That's John Lewis, that's Martin Luther King. You know, that's the people who truly believe it's possible to solve racism or wake up every day. I mean, all of us who worked with her, she would say, we have got to stop child abuse. And every single day that we hadn't stopped child abuse was a day that we probably hadn't worked hard enough at it. So I carry her curiosity, her deep desire to continue learning, to be curious, to not need to know the answer, to try to get it right and not be right, to learn from those around us about what it means to do better and what our experiences are as human beings, in my heart as my legacy, the way that her legacy lives on through me. And I look forward to continue to do kind of my best on her behalf in all aspects of my life, and to share that with all of you that are here, because I know it's true for all of us here. And thank you so much, dear family, many of whom have traveled far and wide to be here. And without further ado, Walt.
Thank you very much, Nadezhda and John. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Walt Gramley, one of Mary Curtis's children. And along with myself and the rest of my family, I want to thank all of those gathered here today This is there's an unmistakable joy and gratitude, I think, in being able to gather here. We also greatly appreciate the opportunity to participate in today's program and the consideration you all have extended us as a family to be able to work together to honor Mom's life and work. I have no doubt that our remarks will have a familiar ring to them and will rest nicely alongside the thoughts and words of others speaking here today. It's truly remarkable to hear the many instances where Mom had an impact on individuals, families, communities, and most of all, children. What is even more remarkable is to see the parallels in our experiences with Mom and the traits she instilled in all of us. It speaks to how she treated everyone she encountered. The people, experiences, relationships, and most of all, the children and families impacted by Mom's work represent a rich tapestry that is at once wonderful and sustaining. There's a quote from Richard Bach that I particularly like and have referenced before. It goes like this: "Family is not always defined by blood. Rarely do members of one family grow up under the same roof." Today is confirmation of that. Confirmation that Mom treated so many as family, and affirmation that there can be many manifestations of family and community that are not limited by blood, but grounded in caring and love. In the time that has passed since Mom died, amongst the many emotions and memories that emerge, there have been a few recurring thoughts that speak to what she meant to us, and I'm sure many of you all here today. A prominent one is the idea that Mom's was a selfless and purposeful life. It's a simple phrase, but one that I think carries a profound weight and represents the commitment, determination, and deep sense of caring that guided her in the work that she did. It was also an idea that she worked to instill in all of us, and I think guides us to this day. A second thought is one of genuine humility, a humility that means all people are equal and deserving of our respect, our support, and our love, and to be treated first and foremost as human beings. Lastly is the idea of being present in all that you do. Mom was present, making the most of even brief interactions. Those who spent time with her felt that. I know we certainly did. I remain amazed at how much Mom accomplished and the truly meaningful impact she had on those she encountered simply by being present. We all have great memories of Mary Curtis. Too many to cover here today, and I'm sure wonderful ones will be spoken of as we go through today's program. We thought we'd offer just a couple along those lines. Most of you all know Mom from what I would call the later years. But before a PhD in early childhood education, before the Family Nurturing Center, before the sustained advocacy for children and families at risk, there were the five of us children. We like to think we were test cases for many of Mom's theories. And while I'm pretty confident we turned out okay, it's a little bit of debate there, but I know many of you all can identify with that sentiment. Mom was also quite competitive and didn't like to lose, especially at ping pong. But somehow she could make it so you couldn't stay mad at her in defeat. Perhaps this was her way of teaching us a little bit of perseverance or the idea of not giving up. Again, I know many of you all saw this in her determination and unwavering commitment to the cause. A note from our sister Jane. Mom was always a source of inspiration, support, guidance, and love. Her dedication to all of us children was phenomenal. As a little girl, I can remember telling her how much I loved horses. That started my lifelong journey with horses, and Mom was there to support me every step along the way, beginning with 4-H when I was 4 years old, through many years of horse shows around the Northwest, and to this day, horses are an important part of my life. I will always cherish horses, and much of that I attribute to Mom. She taught me how to work hard, do your best, be humble. Horses are a part of me just like the inspiration to help others is a part of me. For that, I'm eternally grateful to Mom. In her final weeks as Mom transitioned to hospice, she was determined to speak with each of her grandchildren individually. In typical Mom fashion, this was not a quick call to just say hello. She was genuinely interested in speaking with them directly, one-on-one. It included her preparing a list of questions on a notepad, questions that centered on who they are, what was important to them, where did they see their lives going. She took pains to make sure they had the time to speak with her when it was convenient for them. She remarked afterwards how lucky she felt to be able to do it, thoughtfully recounting the conversations and the unique qualities she found in each of them and what wonderful kids they are. All of these conversations were unique to each of our kids and represented her belief that they are their own people. This is exactly how she saw the five of us, all different, but all deserving of respect and individual recognition. It also reminded us of one of Mom's greatest qualities, meeting children where they are. Pull out pictures of Mom, as I'm sure many of you have over the recent months, and you are struck by how if children are playing on the floor, Mom was right down there with them. If they were working in the dirt or sitting at a small table, Mom was there in the dirt with them or sitting on a chair right alongside. Not surprisingly, as our children recounted their conversations with Grammy, they were incredibly honored and thankful. And I think that kind of sums up how we all feel. To experience and be a beneficiary of Mom's love and support was remarkable and leaves us feeling incredibly lucky and grateful. To know that so many others encountered her kindness, thoughtfulness, and genuine caring makes it all pretty incredible and that much more humbling. I'll finish with one more quote from Richard Bott. When we come to the last moment of this lifetime and we look back across it, the only thing that's going to matter is, what is the quality of our love? For Mom, I know we can say that the quality of that love knew no bounds, and we are all better people for it. We are excited to see where her legacy will lead others now and who it will benefit, and we remain truly honored to be part of that journey. Thank you, Mom. Thank you. And now I'd like to turn it over to Brother Joe for a little brief music interlude.
Thank you, Walt. I think it's wonderful to sort of bookend this as the youngest. We heard from Janie and Walt. Before the Volvo, there was the bright red Volkswagen Dasher diesel wagon. Yes, indeed. And Mom was my first tour manager. I'm a musician, I'm a percussionist, so everywhere I go, I have to, what we call, schlep gear, or move the instruments. And so the first trip we made was in 1984 to Ashland, to SOU, before the SOU years that Mary-Curtis was. And I remember waking up the morning that we got, so we drove late at night, woke up in the morning in Ashland, and I was struck by those amazingly beautiful mountains that are, I think, south of the highway. Anyway, Mom was the very first tour manager, and to this day, she's the best tour manager. Mary-Curtis loved the University of North Carolina, especially the basketball team, so I went back into my collection of what we call mallets, and I got some mallets from 1988, which are Carolina blue. Mary-Curtis loved flowers, so I thought I'd add one purple mallet on the lower side in honor of her. So I struggled with what to play today. I wanted to find the right piece of music. Went back and forth a lot. Nadezhda was incredibly helpful in this, as was Diggs, Dad, Dale. You get the drift. So I came up with a piece that I had commissioned actually from a friend. His name is Kojiro Umezaki. He's from Japan. And I think it's fitting because it contains some elements that I believe speak to mom and her legacy and memory. The first is that Kojiro recorded waves. You're going to hear the waves through these speakers. He recorded waves on the East Coast, and he recorded waves here on the West Coast. He also utilized the very first and only phonograph recording of Walt Whitman reading the Whitman poem, America. Ko then coupled all of that with sound samples from Dvorak's New World Symphony. Bum, 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 bum. So there are four elements to this piece. I'm just the fourth, and our goal here is to have them all balanced. You're going to hear Whitman's voice on the recording. I'm going to say the words here because it's a little grainy. Yes, it was 1892. You're going to hear the phonograph going around and around. America, center of equal daughters of equal sons, all alike, endeared, grown, ungrown, young or old, strong, ample, fair, enduring, capable, rich, perennial with the earth, with freedom, law, and love.
That was absolutely beautiful. Thank you, Joe. I'd like to introduce Dr. Lee Murdoch, who is going to take us through the next part of our celebration this afternoon, which is a discussion, and you get to hear from some of the community people and agencies that were impacted. So welcome, Dr. Murdoch.
Well, goodness sakes, it's good to see everybody here. Lots of people, lots of memories for Mary-Curtis. I first was involved with the Family Nurturing Center in, about 12 years ago in 2010. And Walt maybe mentioned, anyway, my first impression was I walked in and so what's going on? Well, the kids are all down on the floor and the teachers are down on the floor playing and everybody's smiling and having a good time. And so then I said, well, okay, now what? I said, no, that's it. I mean, the kids are here learning to play and learning to relate. So it was an important introduction. It was a smallish organization in 2010. There was lots and lots of hard work. Mary-Curtis, we used to talk about the green car, the Volvo, being there at the Family Nurturing Center 80 or 90 hours a week. I mean, that's not a stretch. Church, the St. Mark's Church, was letting us use their Sunday school as an office, and we went for $1 a year. So we had lots of help. The board worked hard trying to raise money. We raised it a little. We weren't very good, but we tried hard. And Diggs kept the place running. I mean, we carpentry and plumbing and, I mean, whatever. He had it working. So, you know, how did that all work? Well, so it was we worried in our board meetings, we worried, do we have enough money? Do we have enough money? And somehow Mary-Curtis would make it work, by just a little bit. Anyway, in 2014, Mary-Curtis moved on to manage the Southern Oregon Hub, which is an organization to manage the child care kinds of things in Southern Oregon, and then went on from that to help found and start the Oasis Center, which is a hugely valuable thing. I continue to be impressed today that the project of focusing on kids, 0 to 5 particularly, and their families, is maybe the most important thing we can do as a culture. 20 years ago, I don't think, my impression was people thought of kids as being 5 when they started at school. And now people realize kids actually, right out of the womb, that's important time, and even prenatal. It's a really important time, and that's Mary-Curtis's legacy from my standpoint. She taught us all that. As you'll hear a little later, there is a movement in Southern Oregon to develop a program that extends the function, basically the Family Nurturing Center, to all the people, all the kids, all the people in Southern Oregon. And there's a model which I'll talk about a little later. But anyway, that's, in a few words, that's her legacy, and I think it's really important. So thank you all for coming.
That handoff didn't go quite as smoothly. Doug, come on up. Doug, you will introduce the next speaker.
Who is Lisa?
You got it. Yeah, you're gonna bring Lisa up, okay?
Okay. Go. All right. Howdy, everybody. It's good to see everybody here. And I'm so glad that we could have this at the farm. It's like we wouldn't be here without Mary-Curtis, you know, and like to, of all the special things about her, one thing that I just love is like how she allowed us to be so creative, because you would never think that like a preschool teacher to be like, hey, we should have a farm program also. Like, and she, it's like, let's work that out. And So anyway, I'm glad we're here. But I think I'll start actually with something that Dig said, which seems like a good idea because I know it'll be more concise and insightful than what I could think of. But, you know, we were talking and he said, it's so interesting now to be able to like have this opportunity to kind of have a different perspective about Mary-Curtis's work. Because, you know, we like to think of Mary-Curtis's sweet granny, this nice, kind, gracious, graceful woman, but also to remember that, like, she was fierce. She never stopped working. She made perhaps a strong-willed a little, and that she would never rest on her laurels. She would never take time to think of what the great work we've done, how much we have accomplished. It was always like, what can we do better? What needs are not being met, and how are we going to meet those needs? What are we going to do about that? And so through that process, that's how the Nurturing Center got started. And one thing of her legacy, I think, is just that, because thinking of what that was like, the space she created there, it was beautiful, and a space that was predicated on work that involved doing the right thing always for each kid, each family, even though that could be different. It wasn't like, this is the thing we do. The thing we do is build relationship, get to know those children, the families, you have conversation with them. And that is how the program developed. And she had a relationship with every family that came through there, every kid. They would sit in her office with her. And that is how she was able to speak in the community and to form this space where that work could be done with joy and beauty, which was so important to her, both those things. And it wasn't just a directive from her, that's how she did that. She built the relationship. Every interaction with her was full of joy and connection with children, all the way from the Nurturing Center down to when we at the start of Oasis. Just 3 years ago, I felt so lucky. We did the Breakfast Club group over there, and moms from the moms program would come with their baby. And you look, and there's Mary-Curtis on the floor, like you said, playing with those kids with the joy and seeing the joy reciprocated back from that child. And like, that's how it's done. And she showed us how to do it that way. And it was just a beautiful place to work, and it's just grown, and her legacy lives on in that. But the other ways, it's just the impact in the community that happened in so many ways, from her going out and speaking, always at meetings, collaborating, in partnership. I saw her speak so many times to groups of people, and every time there's like one person crying, at least, one person writing a check, at least, and five other people getting up and being inspired to go do this work. And that went out into the community. And then when I think of my own experience with her, and she's like the mother of my true self and showed me this path. And not only that, but like prepared us to do this. How do we do this work? And I can multiply that by everyone out here by 100 times and think all of us going out into the community to do this work and to see it's now at its Oasis. It's out at like nonprofits being started on the coast. It's at CDC. It's at the Veterans Administration. Everywhere, all the people that she took under her wing are in the community doing this work. And that is part of her legacy as well. And I think the most important part of her legacy, though, is the families that came through the Nurturing Center that changed, that got the support and the connection. And they're out in the community now. And Mary-Curtis, she would always say, like, where we're really going to see the work is when these little kids that we are in the classroom, when they're parents, when they have kids. And that is coming to be now. And we're seeing children, although it makes me feel so old every time. I was like, oh my God. But like that they're having children, their parents, those children are going out. And the work that is done with the parents, then the children, it manifests now in this next generation, and this is where we're really going to see the impact. And this is what she gave to our community, is immense, indescribable, and like so beautiful, just like she was. And I know that she's in all of us, all the families, everyone that worked there, everybody in the community. And so I can just say so confidently that, you know, Mary-Curtis lives, and she is in all of us still. And it's our work is to go out there and finish this up for her. And it'll never be done, I know. We'll all be the same way, like Nadezhda said, being like, oh, we did not fix the world. But we made it better, and that's the thing. And that's what she drives us to do, and I'm so thankful for that from her. That's all. Oh. And next up, the woman who has like taken on the legacy and like the work of Mary-Curtis at FNC, Lisa O'Connor. Thank you.
Wow. It is an honor to be around so many incredible people and to celebrate such an incredible human, friend, mentor, inspiration. She was more than life, larger than life by far. I met Mary-Curtis over 20 years ago. I had no idea how our lives would be intertwined from that moment on. But every time I made a mistake or every time I got stuck, everyone would say, well, have you met Mary-Curtis Gramley? And I would call Mary-Curtis. And she'd always have words of wisdom for me or set me straight if my thinking wasn't quite right. MC knew and appreciated and understood children like no other. She was fascinated by them. I loved watching her stand and look in the classroom, and she'd say, I wonder what they're thinking about. Not what they're doing, not what they're learning. What are they thinking about? What are they getting out of this experience? And she mostly was curious about the best way to help a child heal from trauma. You know, Brené Brown says that curiosity is an irreducible component of courageous leadership. When I heard that, I immediately thought of Mary-Curtis. Thanks to her curiosity and her courageousness, she really took on trying to solve all the problems of the world and some really complex issues with no fear. And due to that, thanks to her courageousness, we now serve over 2,300 families a year in the legacy that she built. Whoops. She was so proud of how far we've come, how many families that we get to meet. She was excited about where we're going. I would often check in with her. I always said that I was the foster parent for her baby, and I wanted to make sure we were on the same parenting plan. And so at the, you know, the very end, she was telling me that I was telling her all the things that were happening and what we were going to do. And she said, well, she was especially interested in our work with the babies because we got to get them early, and we got to get them as early as possible, get them started, the earlier the better. She knew the essential ingredient of helping a child is putting an emphasis on bringing the entire family forward. She knew how important it was for us to meet people where they were at, and that that's different for every single person that we come across. She had no grand illusions about the struggles that families faced. She honored them, she cheered them on, and she let them know it was going to be okay. I think she was also acutely aware of families that were struggling with substance use disorder. That was something that she really cued in on and talked for a long time before Oasis finally came online. So excited for you guys to all hear about that adventure. The last time that I spoke with MC, she let me know that it was my responsibility. Diggs was there, I think you can vouch for this, that every child in Jackson and Josephine County need to start school ready to learn. She wanted them all to have that equal playing field. Her concerns were centered to find better and more effective ways to help families rebuild their lives. She wanted to make sure that every single person in that family was cared for along that journey. We know that sometimes as adults we get so caught up in our own lives or something as challenging as substance use that oftentimes the kids were forgotten. And so the work that she has shared with all of us does live in us today and will live on forever. I wanted you all to know that the work is not done, and she would be telling us that. So nothing is going to, you know, if anything else, you know, I have some laundry list items that I need to accomplish before I pass the torch on to someone else. But really, you know, when I shared with her, thanks to a gift that we got via Senator Golden, we are going to purchase a new campus. And I struggled with telling her, you know, that I wanted to name that campus after her because I knew she wouldn't like it. She doesn't care about where her name's at or what she's accomplished. It's not about her. But she was honored and said thank you and sweet things about you, Mr. Golden. She also was excited about our housing project. You know, when we get ready to, the church has been so good to us. It's kind of scary to even think about knocking Dagwell Hall down. But when we do, to turn that into housing, I promise that Diggs is going to get the first swing at the sledgehammer because no one deserves it more than you, Diggs. And lastly, you know, Brené Brown also said that sadness moves the individual us towards the collective us. MC would rather we put our sadness into action to do what we can do to ensure that every child in Southern Oregon has the life that they deserve. And so I would just like to invite you all to do your part to make her proud. Use your voice, advocate, volunteer, donate. Encourage a parent in line at the grocery store whose child is screaming, whatever it is, please just remember to do your part. She's watching.
I'm Carrie Heacox, and this is Kristen Johnson, and we just wanted to talk a little bit about the influence that Mary Curtis has had on us and the work we're doing now. I first met Mary-Curtis when I was the child abuse medical examiner at the Children's Advocacy, and she was the executive director of the Family Nurturing Center. And I was immediately drawn to her because she was really working to prevent the child abuse and neglect that I was seeing every day in my own work. I eventually served on the Family Nurturing Center board, and as I evolved in my own career, I started to want to move more upstream as well as she did, trying to prevent some of the things that we see that impact children every day. And so that led to me into addiction medicine, because at the Advocacy Center, and I think at the Nurturing Center, we saw really the profound effect that addiction can have on parents and their inability to be protective of their children. You know, not that they don't love their children, it's just it changes the way you think about things. And so as I evolved in that work and Mary-Curtis evolved in her work, we started talking about what do these children and families really need to kind of break that cycle of addiction and really bring these kids into an environment that's supportive of not the child, just the child, but the whole family. And so, you know, some of the things we talked about, services were really fragmented. People involved in children and families' lives didn't really talk to each other very much. And we thought about, wow, it would be great if we could bring all of those things into one place. So we started to dream up an agency for that. And we had a white paper, which turned into what the Oasis Center is now. And we started talking to people, and Mary-Curtis mostly did the talking in her polite, persuasive, and persistent way, because I knew she would be way better at it than I was. And really talking to people, and just the idea of this agency became tangible and real to me working with her in a way that I don't think it ever would have had I been on my own. And so in 2019, we opened the Oasis Center, which is a family-centered medical clinic, really focusing on parents with substance use disorders and their young children, also on pregnant women. And it really, I'm profoundly grateful for the influence and the guidance that Mary-Curtis gave me with making this agency a possibility.
Today, Oasis has grown to serve hundreds of families, and we continue to learn and evolve. An important strength of this program is connecting community partners to work together to support families in all stages of recovery to improve the lives of children. When I reflect on my friendship and relationship with Mary Curtis, I'm reminded of her strength in bringing people together to solve problems. She brought people together to listen and to develop an understanding of an issue, to work together to find a solution, to come together to build a common vision where we could all see the absolute possibility of a world where children and families thrive. It is also her strength in bringing people together that is at the heart of OASIS. This is a place where parents and children can build a community, support each other, and hold each other up. We are honored to carry forward the work and vision of Mary Curtis, and there is still so much work to be done. And today, she's brought us all together. I'm pleased to share that the Mary Curtis Memorial Fund is being directed towards a Family Nurturing Center and OASIS partnership. Together, we're developing dedicated classrooms for OASIS Center children to receive therapeutic services and family support at the Nurturing Center. This was a project that Lisa and I were fortunate to have discussed with Mary Curtis, and this partnership will serve such important people in our community. It's our hope to begin this project by the new year. Thank you for your support, and thank you to Mary Curtis.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Next, I'd like to introduce Diane, who is coming up to the stage right now, and she's going to take a few moments to speak to you about sort of what it was like to be subject to the work of Mary Curtis and those programs. So thank you. Welcome, Diane.
Thank you. Hi. First, I want to say that I'm incredibly humbled and grateful to be standing here talking to all of you. If you don't know me, my name is Diana Cooper. I'm the executive director and founder of Brookings Core Response on the coast. I do know some of you, and I think that there's probably quite a few of us here that wouldn't have met without Mary Curtis, and that's especially true for me. I don't think there's anybody in this room that I would know without Mary Curtis. She made things possible for me, for my family, and for a lot of families like mine. I came to the Nurturing Center in 2013 when my family went to treatment and we were very broken. My children had experienced a lot of trauma and my husband and I were struggling. I heard everybody kind of talk about the children, and I heard Doug and Lisa kind of hint to the parents as well. And I will say that in our addiction, we often do forget the welfare of our children. And in our recovery, sometimes we forget the welfare of the parents. And Mary Curtis always kept us in mind. As parents, she wanted to make sure that the whole family healed and not just the children. Because oftentimes the parents are the ones that can help heal the children the most. You know, we know where that damage came from. Matt and I, we wanted to find some support in helping our children heal from trauma. And I remember when we first got there, two of my children were, I have four children, and my two middle children were really acting out a lot when we first got to treatment. I think when you get there, there's a lot of sense of safety that comes out, and children then start acting out because they feel safe in the environment that they're in. And so we got referred to the Family Nurturing Center. And I remember we started with PCIT, the parent-child interaction therapy, and with Wendy, and I remember thinking, I don't understand how just sitting and playing with my kids for 5 minutes is gonna stop them from biting each other. It just didn't make sense to me. And it took one day for their behaviors to start changing and for our behaviors to start changing and for us to start acting differently with them and seeing how special it is just to let them lead. And that was something that we've never heard of, we've never experienced. You know, Matt and I, my husband and I both didn't have parents that we could turn to. We didn't have anybody we could turn to before we came to the Family Nurturing Center. And then we found a lot of people there. When I started college, we were both working. We were still going to treatment, and the Nurturing Center supported us. They offered us extra respite for Noah when there was space. When we moved into our first apartment after treatment, we had no air conditioning, no heat, and then we found out we had bed bugs. And it was the staff at the Nurturing Center that supported us until we could move. One day, our car got a flat tire, and I called the Nurturing Center expecting to hear Colette's voice. And instead, I heard this older, southern, sweet woman. And I explained the situation, and she said, I'll call you back. And she called me back maybe a half hour later, and she said, why don't you go ahead and come in, and I'm going to give you the money for the tire. And I thought, this is the nicest volunteer I've ever met. They should keep her. And I went in, and that's when I met Mary Curtis. She engaged with me pretty quickly, asked me questions. She always had questions for me every time we met. And then I came to start having questions for her too. And if it wasn't for her, I wouldn't have been brought into the world of healing, nonprofit work, social work. I probably just would have went to treatment and lived out my life, and I have no idea where I would be. Shortly after we met, she asked me if I would come speak at some little thing. And Kristen asked me to speak today, and she said, you love speaking. That's not entirely true. Mary Curtis asked me to speak a lot, and so it may have just looked like I liked speaking, but really I just couldn't say no to Mary Curtis, because how can you say no to her? So the organization that I founded and that I run, and I'm honored to lead, is really the result of my passion and Mary Curtis's tempering. There were a couple of years there where I didn't know how I was going to start it. I remember going to Brad, and I remember going to Mary Curtis and sitting down with both of them individually. And Mary Curtis and I met often at Starbucks, and she would pick my brain about things for Oasis, and I would pick her brain about things for my own work that I wanted to continue doing. And so when I moved back to my community, she was an invaluable resource to me, and she's one of the few key people, and a few here that I've seen, who still supported me, would take my stressed out calls or texts or emails. And there's so much I still wish that I could ask her. There are a lot of times where in the work that I'm doing, I really wish I could sit and have a conversation with her again. And I miss sitting with her and talking to her, and she always had amazing questions to ask. My last email to her was in the months before she passed, and I was going through something outrageous, and I was hoping that she would give me some wisdom, and I told her I was going to be talking to Kristen about it, and I expected her to respond with the questions in her usual way, but instead she said, I think you're handling everything well, and I'm confident that Kristen will be a great support on the matter and many things to come, and she was not wrong. Kristen, Brad, Sabina, some of you that are here, these are the people that she brought into my life, or rather, she brought me into yours. Her ability to bring people to get together for the benefit of everyone was her superpower. Her legacy is thousands of families, and I'm one. It's not just the children, it's the parents. It's the grandparents, it's the cousins, it's just everybody that was involved. She wanted to make sure they healed together. I will leave you with my favorite piece of MC advice, which is, it now has a much deeper meaning to me as an executive director. If you want to get something done, ask someone who's busy. Thank you all for being a part of my story and letting me speak.
Thank you, Diana. Dr. Murdoch is going to share some words from Peter Buckley. You're good, Doc. Come on up.
Yeah, it was interesting. You heard all these things, stories from different people. It was Well, early on when I was involved with a family nurturing center, people would say, well, what's that all about? Is that kind of a nursery school? A daycare, kind of drop your kids off for a couple hours so the parents can go shopping or whatever. So you see, actually, it's a much, much bigger deal. It's the whole family. It's getting to know what's really going on. Anyway, we invited Peter to come talk to you. Peter's the director of Southern Oregon Success. I don't know if you know what that is or not. It's a organization that you probably kind of works under the radar on purpose, actually. They coordinate with a lot of people who deal with kids to improve. You've heard people talk about the ACE study and the people who are giving instruction about the ACE study. Well, that's part of what Peter does with his group. Anyway, his words from Peter. I am very, very sorry I can't be there with you today. I have the rare opportunity to see my sister, my brother, my niece and nephew, and more importantly, my great niece and great nephew this weekend. I'm not able to get back home in time. As you all know, family really matters, as does the life, work, and legacy of Mary Curtis. I was asked to let you know a bit about the regional and statewide work that is being done now following Mary Curtis's footsteps. The simplest way I can explain it is that we're taking what she has inspired and accomplished through the Family Nurturing Center and Oasis Center, as well as her passionate advocacy year after year after year, and we're working on it to scale up till it reaches every child and family in Oregon. Former Governor John Kitzhaber has offered a title for the effort, a Child Success Delivery System. What if we were to create a system that has never existed before, a system that offers family-centered home visiting programs, preschools, child care centers, and wraparound support services at any level any family might need to ensure that every child has an opportunity to thrive? Because of the work of Mary Curtis and many others of you here today, Southern Oregon has been asked to be the first region in the state, or the country for that matter, to develop a blueprint of just what a child success delivery system could be. Our Southern Oregon Success Collaboration has set a regional goal that aligns directly with Mary Curtis' life work, that every child enters kindergarten ready to thrive. The Child Success Delivery System is envisioned as the vehicle to make this happen first here and throughout the state. The process we're engaged in is not just to build upon the great work that has been done now, but to dream and bring into reality a system with families at the center and the work of everyone in education, healthcare, human services, workforce development, housing, community development, public safety, woven together to bring resources and support upstream at long last where they need to be for every child to have a chance to thrive, starting here and growing outward. It's a goal on a scale of ambition that we hope matches the scale of passion, creativity, intelligence, and accomplishment seen in the life of Mary Curtis. We hope to make her proud. Please get in touch with me, Peter Buckley, if you are not already and would like to join this effort. It's going to take all of us. And so that's what he had to say. He is sorry he couldn't be here. It's a, he had to agreed to come. And then his wife told him, oh, no, you have to go to California, San Francisco. Anyway. Southern Oregon Success, you can check it out online to be involved. It's actually, this process is moving forward as we speak, and hope to be, the obvious thing is how much does that all cost? And Governor Kitzhaber thinks that he can find the funding for it. So it's just, it'll start small in Southern Oregon, depending on our success. It will be a nationwide thing. It just makes so much sense, obviously. Anyway, I think there'd be a lot less trouble in the world if we'd all started off
with help like this.
Thank you very much.
And next, help me complete this sentence. Behind every great woman is a great man. I get the honor of introducing, I've heard, Dad Dale Diggs. In my family, he is one of the top five hardest working people I have ever known in my life. And I've had the honor of building play structures and fences and painting and basically whatever Mary-Curtis asked us to do, and Dale ripped me into. So with that said, Diggs, Dale, Dad, you want to come on up?
All right, Chief. Well, my goodness. I feel like we ought to do a seventh inning stretch or something, because you've had to sit here and listen and listen and listen, and now you've got me. So if you don't mind, and my kids don't mind, I'm going to go ahead and say a few things. And we've all said something differently, and we've chosen words that have tried to describe Mary-Curtis. I will try to do that my way, and I will read, because that's the only way I think I can do this. So I will appreciate your listening to me, putting up with me, with my long-winded statement. So if you don't mind, I do, first of all, want to thank all of you for being here, because being here, you're honoring Mary-Curtis. She would be overwhelmed. I will admit, it was a challenge when thinking what I might say. I concluded, there is no perfection of words with which to honor Mary-Curtis. My thinking instead looked to others for words already written. Those words were written at different times, in different places, by four different individuals. Their words come closest to describing and capturing a satisfying expression about a journey taken and a life lived so well. What I shall read to you, hopefully, gives you a sense of the universe Mary-Curtis lived in and we traveled. I'd like to begin with a poem many of you will recognize immediately. It was written about a century ago, and it is as fresh today as when it was written. The poem's message served us as a poignant omen for a journey that we began at the outset of our 60 years of marriage. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both. And be one traveler, long I stood and looked down one as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth. Excuse me. Then took the other, as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves. No step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled, and that has made all the difference. Robert Frost, The Road Not Taken. I'm going to turn to an entirely different source and tone of writing. I have taken excerpts from a larger collection of words written about Mary Curtis as an individual and about the two of us together. The excerpts were written at different times over the past year. They are taken from our story, which I recently completed. You could ask the question, how did we get here? Well, when we drove to Oregon in an old Volkswagen bus in 1969 at age 32, with our little kids scattered in the back of that van, Mary Curtis and I did not know what we were about to create for ourselves. We hadn't thought much beyond a place to live where we could watch our kids grow up and live a reasonable life. Instead, we found ourselves setting out on what may be described as an odyssey that took us to several Oregon locations, to two other states, and finally back to Oregon. Our self-created odyssey followed a circle we did not know we were traversing. That circle was leading us to something we were searching for, but did not know what it might be, nor did we know how it would be clothed. We could have missed it entirely. If so, our odyssey would have been incomplete, and none of us would be gathered here today. Somehow, with unforeseen changes and circumstances, that far-reaching circle brought us to the Rogue Valley. Over time, the incubation process already stirring in Mary Curtis's mind transformed her vision into bold reality. It became my privilege serving with her as she created the Family Nurturing Center and later Oasis with Carrie Hecox. Simply put, we came upon real purpose together in partnership. It wasn't until we were both age 67 that we found where we were supposed to be. We did not know a circle's greater wisdom had been silently guiding us throughout our journey. We could begin to understand that. The birth of the Family Nurturing Center became the most natural, significant, rewarding, and fascinating gift of our entire odyssey. Of all the purposes presented to us over the years, we had learned that true purpose is real purpose. Real purpose is the one that touches the heart. The circumference of our far-reaching circle finally had been joined. Without our being aware, that circle had waited patiently for us to get here. The question may be asked, who was she? Mary Curtis's life with children began in a second grade classroom in Burlington, North Carolina, at age 22. She stopped working with children at age 82. Over that period of time, she gave a lifetime of service to the most vulnerable in our population. She was born into a way of life that began as a latent presence within her. It gradually grew and manifested itself over time. Her mind began stoking an active passion for very young children as she gave uncommon dedication and conviction to what she believed. She never doubted herself, and she never looked back, because she was always looking ahead to what children needed to make their lives whole. She made her life whole by what she did for others. She gave something for others to see larger than themselves. How could you calculate a true measure of the distance traveled, or the people touched, or the children who became better than they otherwise would have been? It is not quantifiable. She had a quality of humility with strength, a questioning mind seeking answers, and a will to push beyond accepted norms. She did this in a natural and unforced manner, always, as you know, with a smile, a southern graciousness, and a smoothness of elocution. It was an essential ingredient that she grew up with and brought with her from the little town of Graham, North Carolina, so many years ago. She talked about writing a book, documenting her views and experience surrounding her work with children. Its seeds would have been planted the first day she taught those second graders in North Carolina, to writing her dissertation about children at the University of Oregon 30 years later, to her vision of the Family Nurturing Center and Oasis. It would be full of wisdom gained and truth told about children, what she learned from them, and the hope she could see in the eyes of a child. It would be her story, and one she would have wanted to tell. She and I, over the years, too easily said on different occasions, "Oh yes, sometime we will tell our story." With the passage of time, it became the more urgent to tell. That someday did come. It came too late for her to tell. Instead, we are honoring Mary Curtis and her story as she lived it. Her story transformed itself into a legacy. This service is testimony to that. In many ways, her story is a simple one. It is all the more powerful and profound in its simplicity because it is a story about children. It was lived to reach into where a child's world lives. It is a story about hope. How fulfilling, how wonderful, how lucky we have been. A few days ago, I was casually putting away a stack of loose papers. A single sheet of paper fluttered to the floor. I picked it up, was about to put it back, hesitated, and then quickly glanced at it. Mary Curtis had kept it. It was a letter written on lined notebook paper. It had no date and was written with a pencil in cursive handwriting. Through the wonder and mystery of life, as though I was missing something so central to our being here today, and I had not paid attention, I was shown something by pure chance. It was a letter that contained as much meaning as anything spoken here today. The something that struck me came from the words of a child. What else, other than the purity of a child, could capture what this is all about? I'm going to read this short letter. It's only a few words, and I'm also going to spell a few of those words as I read it. Dear Mary, capital M-E-R-Y, Curtis, small c, U-R-T-U-S. you are the nicest person I've, I-V-E, ever known. I hope I could see you again and soon. I really, R-E-L-Y, like you. I'll probably go to the next class with you. Then there was a heart drawn with an arrow through it. Love, Tarney. With words spoken late in her life and dictated to me by Mary Curtis, we wrote her obituary. I will close now my remarks with her words. She speaks to each of us only as she could do. As you might imagine, true to Mary Curtis's passion for children, she could not leave us without making a final statement. The last two paragraphs of her obituary are as follows. I have had the privilege of working with amazing professional caregivers over many years. It has been an honor to share concerns and contribute time and effort to very young children at risk. My level of concern and care has been a commitment to these children as future citizens of this community. My belief in their viability and capacity to become positive members of this community rests with our investment in them individually and collectively. Each child's well-being deserves respect, top to bottom. I am thankful for the opportunities I have had, the meaning it has given my life, and the joy each child has brought to it. Please do not let our children down. Their voice must be heard because our listening will give them hope. Inclusion, diversity, and understanding must accompany the work that follows. It is the child that empowers and creates the needed change and success of all programs. October 24th, 1936 to May 17th, 2021. Thank you, Mary Curtis.
That's hard to follow, guys. In closing, in front of me are Shasta daisies. Please feel free to take one at the end of the service today. That is Mary Curtis's favorite flower. You'll find seeds and pots in the back. There is food and drinks. Feel free to take the time to mingle. Diggs, Dale, Dad.
I stay confused.
It's very hard to follow you. If you look at your program, there is a link, whatever you call those scan things you do with your cell phone, to a video documentary that is absolutely gorgeous, that is well worth your time. Set around the grounds is information about some of the organizations that Mary Curtis was a part of. I encourage you to look at those and to evaluate them, because in them you will learn what it is that you've heard spoken about today. Solomon said, train up a child. I called the pastor last night and I said, make sure I understand this correctly. And I said, I've always taken that as a personal call. I thought, that's a statement to a parent. I said, is it broader than that? And he says, oh, Hamilton, you got this all wrong. And he says, as much chagrin as I have to say this, Hillary Clinton was right. It takes a village. And he says, this dictate, this command from King Solomon applies to all of us in our responsibility to the children in our community. So I encourage you to take what you heard today, look at the things that Mary-Curtis has done, and find a way individually, either recommit yourself to the idea of training up a child or look for a way to do it. I told you I'd never said no to Mary-Curtis since 1998. I can't think of a single time I said no. I've been Santa. I've roasted her at a community auction. Remember that? I've cleaned toilets. I've painted walls. I've built play structures. I've acted as a lawyer threatening an East Coast organization who wanted to take away the use of Family Nurturing Center. There is no limit to the number of ways that our community and children need you to step in and help. And so with that said, please enjoy the afternoon. Thank you.
I'd just like to say thank you to Mary-Curtis. She impacted so many people's lives. She impacted my life. She was a real guide star for people in the community to step up and work with children and do their best. So thank you, Mary-Curtis.
All right, what Mary-Curtis meant to me, she gave me the opportunity to work at a children's center without having my degree. And along with that came the stipulation that I would continue to go to school and finish that degree. Well, 20 years later, I did finish my early childhood degree and did work for the Oasis Center, and then now work for Early Intervention. So she was very much instrumental in me pursuing that degree and my dream.
Hi, I'm Eileen Mickey Johnson, and I have known Mary-Curtis ever since she came to the Rogue Valley in about 1989 or so. I worked with her at SOU at the Schneider Children's Center. She was our boss. And then later, I worked with her on various projects at SOU and served on the Jackson County Commission on Children and Families. Later, the Southern Oregon Early Learning Services, Early Learning Hub. And she was always my, I thought of her as my mentor, my inspiration for a lot of what I did. She really raised up the early childhood field in Jackson and Josephine counties, I think. And it was a privilege to work so close with her for so many years on so many different projects.
So I met Mary-Curtis when she was just starting the Family Nurturing Center, and I was working in the addiction industry. And all of a sudden I realized this woman who was walking in the room was going to take care of the people who nobody was talking about, and that was the children of the families that we were treating. And over time I came to know her as a friend and a mentor, and I laughed with her. I joined the Family Nurturing Center board for a while. And, you know, I think Mary-Curtis is a personality that none of us will ever forget. She was smart. She was strategic. She did not, nobody, one thing nobody said today is she did not hold take bullshit lightly. She would call the bullshit in a very thoughtful Southern accent way. But she saw quite clearly through whatever was going on. And she did all of that in the service of children. And then she taught me that the service of children is also the service of their parents.
I'm Linda Otto, and I started a nonprofit called Grandmas to Go Family Coaches. I wouldn't have done it without Mary-Curtis's blessing. I read something years ago about how our social services were not reaching all the families that needed support and help. And I went to the person who was the executive director of Healthy Families, and I said, what's happening to all the families that you can't help? If you can only take the highest needs, what's happening for these other families? And she said, there are no services for them. So I studied about how I could possibly start something where community members step up and help our families. And what happened was I put together what I called my master's thesis, which was a huge notebook of all the research I'd done. And I said, what if we get women, baby boomers like me, that really want to help the community, that want to give back? We've got years of our lives left. We've got energy. We've got our health. And I went to Mary-Curtis and I gave her this notebook. And a couple weeks later, we got together and I said, Mary-Curtis, if you tell me this is a viable idea, I will fight for it. And she said, Well, in her sweet Southern accent, it is a good idea. But I've just turned in my resignation to the Family Nurturing Center, and we're starting two new relief nurseries, and I don't see any way our board would take it on, because you should be part of the Family Nurturing Center. So in March of 2020, we became part of the Nurturing Center, and I'm so happy that Mary-Curtis gave me the courage to go on and put together what I thought would help this community. So love you, Mary-Curtis. You are an inspiration to everyone, including me. Thank you so much.
I'm Beth Jeffy Stafford. I'm the clinical director at the Family Nurturing Center, and I worked with Mary-Curtis for many years at the Family Nurturing Center, very, very closely. And to me, I just think about hope when I think about Mary-Curtis. I think about believing in healing, that change is possible, that it's never too late to make a difference in other people's lives or in your own life. And as other people talked about today, I think about Joy. I think about her laughing, and that's meant a lot to me in my work, doing really hard work with people who have suffered and experienced a lot of pain, and holding on to the hope that joy is possible for them and healing is possible. Thank you.
I'm Jenny, and I had the pleasure of spending time with Mary-Curtis and Dale as a couple. We went out on several occasions to dinner, and I just love the way that they got along with each other. They joked a lot, and they made fun of each other in a lovingly way that I really appreciated. They didn't take each other too seriously. Obviously, they adored each other, but that was just a really fun side of Mary-Curtis that I didn't expect. I'll never forget her beautiful voice. I don't think any of us will, and the way that she spoke. But she could get to Diggs and kind of jab him, and I liked that side a lot.
Well, the biggest compliment I ever got in my life was from Mary-Curtis. She called me a water buffalo, and she said I was a water buffalo because I just kept going, and I got it done. And it was really wonderful to hear that from her, because she was a water buffalo. It was a real gift to know somebody like Mary-Curtis, and I love her.
So I got to see Mary-Curtis a few weeks before she passed away, and I will always remember her telling me to always leave heart prints wherever I go in her honor. And I look at that as my lifelong mission, and to keep her always alive in the lives of children and families in our valley. Thank you.
Mary-Curtis changed my life. I know when about 10 years ago, when I was looking for work and employment, she was like, oh, we will put you to work somewhere. Come on. And when I met her, I was drawn to her commitment to families and children. But she also, my child inside of me, she nurtured and held, encouraged, gave opportunity. And this is to me, an adult, but this is to my little girl that she spoke to and took care of. And I am now, I have Mary-Curtis with me, I carry her with me. And I remember just her care and concern and dedication, and love it.
My name's Jeff Golden, and I've been in public life here for a long time. I know Mary-Curtis 10-ish years, and there's just a small number of people that have really sustained me in my activism as I try to do what I can do for the community. And Mary-Curtis is towards the top of that list. And it's, you know, it has to do with a purity of vision. I mean, we have this tendency to make all these issues really complicated. Mary-Curtis didn't do that. This was simply about the well-being of children, period. And if it contributed to that, we ought to do it. And if it didn't, it was just a distraction. And it was like she's connected to Source in a certain way, with this mission that was so clean and simple and motivating. And the way she followed it for decades without wavering inspired me. And when I'd run into a problem in public life, I would think of her and a few people like her. And that was my source. That was my fuel. And I'm just super grateful I got to know her.
I just wanted to say thank you to Mary-Curtis Gramley and her husband, Diggs, for everything they did for me when I got hired at Family Nurturing Center in 2008. Eric Dittmer turned me onto the job, and I will forever be grateful to him for that. I spent 6 years there bookkeeping, and together Mary-Curtis and I garnered $7.8 million in grant money. And that was a large reason that Family Nurturing Center made it through that period. I had fun working for her, with her. She was my mentor. She gave me the time I needed to be with my son, who was incredibly challenging. And I will forever remember her gratefully for that, for getting me through this period, that period of my life. Thank you very much for what you've done. This was really beautiful. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Mary-Curtis was a person that I actually never got to meet in person. I got to speak with her on the phone multiple times. But I will say that you can feel her in the bones of our organization. She is everywhere inside of our walls, inside of our staff. So she's always there. Even though I didn't know her personally, I definitely feel like I do.
I learned so much working with Mary-Curtis, and often when I first was working with her, she would talk to me in questions. So I would come with a problem and I would ask her a question, and she would ask me questions. And at first it was really frustrating because I wanted an answer. And as I grew and learned working there, I realized that she knew that I could find the answer if I would ask the right questions of myself and others. And so I remember one time standing in the classroom and a child was having a difficult behavior, and I paused for a moment and I thought, what is this child trying to tell me? And I was able to come up with the answer in the moment. So some of the things that Mary-Curtis had talked and taught us about came to mind often in the moment because she taught us using all those questions.
I just want to say that Mary-Curtis inspired me to have confidence, and she asked me to watch out for Dale. And as the one man said, you can't say no to Mary-Curtis, so I will be keeping an eye on you, Dale. Yeah.
I just wanted to thank Mary-Curtis for her inspiration and all of the giving that she did for our family and for all of the others that she inspired in the world, and express my gratefulness for the experiences and the support and the love and the teaching of how to be helpful to others. Thank you, Mom.
Mary-Curtis had a good life and had a good time with us, and had a very special things like the garden for one, the watering the plants for two, and I forgot what else.
That's all right, just whatever.
I did all exercising for her, and I did everything for her.